Welcome everybody, you're watching Mr. Fugu Data Science. Today we're doing something pretty cool, cosine similarity, usually found in a data mining course. If you're doing any natural language processing, you'll come across this at some point. Feel free to hit me up here on Instagram and Twitter, as well as if you would like to help support the channel, hit me up right here on Buy Me a Coffee. Let's get into this. Before I forget, thanks to the recent subscribers and viewers, I greatly appreciate it. Here's the imports that you're gonna need right here. Pause the video if you wanna follow along, otherwise go in the link in the description below and get the code from my GitHub. Cosine similarity is something you may remember from your trigonometry class where we're doing a dot product and using the denominator here to create a unit vector for our A and our B. And what you're essentially doing is looking at the angle measure between the two vectors, and you're looking to see if there's a higher value of theta, then you'll have a lower value for your cosine of theta, which would mean that the similarity value would be lower. So the value you get back from the cosine theta would be lower, meaning that if we were comparing two documents, for example, document A and document B, and if there was a large angle between those two vectors, then that would mean that we have a dissimilar or not likely similar text. So essentially what we're doing, if you expand this out, we're doing the sum A and B divided by the square root of the sum of A squared multiplied by square root of the sum of B squared. Let's look at an example real quick of what this would look like if we did it by hand. If we had these two vectors A and vector B of length, I think it's 7 or 8, 8. We would first do the dot product to get our numerator of A and B. Then we would do the squaring of each of the terms, then add those together, and then take the square root of that. Do the same thing for A, multiply them together, and then divide both of them and see what you get. In this case, we would have a similarity of 0.417. You're going from 0 to 1 on your scale, so that would mean it's almost halfway there. Let's see what this looks like when we're actually using text documents, because what you're doing is using word counts. What we're going to use today are some tweets. I have 50 tweets that I got a few months ago, and here they are right here. We're going to extract those out and start manipulating those. From those 50 tweets, I did some regular expressions to show you something that we need to get rid of, which is going to be highly useless. Not all of the entries will have links, but we need to take care of these. So I'm going to extract those and replace them with an empty space. So I take those tweets, I use our pattern, and I use the regular expression compile, and I iterate through our pandas series that contains our 50 tweets. And I'm substituting with an empty space here and appending everything as a list. And here's the first two entries of what we got back. Remember the first one that we had a link to it. And you'll notice this ellipsis where the text was continuing or ended abruptly for some reason. That's not going to help us in our analysis, but I want you to just be aware of this, all right? One thing that you can do if you're trying to standardize these texts, I would consider making everything lowercase beforehand. And that would be one thing I would consider in terms of taking out your stop words, for instance, or useless words. I'm not sure if that's necessary when you're doing cosine similarity or not. We'll call in from sklearn our feature extraction text to import the count vectorizer, which is allowing us to create our frequency counts for each of the words, and we'll be basing those words off of columns, if we're throwing that into a data frame, and our rows will be the number of entries we had or number of tweets, which would be 50. We're using the count vectorizer with our stop words for English, and then we're doing a fit transform on that to create our sparse matrix. Let's print these off real quick, zoom out a little bit, and see what these look like, all right? So we can see each one of these steps. Convert this into our matrix and flatten it out, and then chuck it into our pandas data frame, allowing us to take our new matrix, our document matrix, and the names from our features. And that's what's printed off here. You'll see a bunch of zeros, but it is working because you'll see these counts here. You just have a lot of words, which is right there. We'll move on to our cosine similarity, doing pairwise comparisons here. We'll throw in our data frame, and then you have the option of doing a dense output or not. And I'll just print this off so you can see what this looks like. You'll notice that this first entry, so at 00, 11, 22, 33, etc., all the way to 50-50 on the diagonals, they're all going to equal 1 because that's doing your first row tweet, your first column tweet are the same exact tweet. So if this was from the first row for your original data frame, that's the same thing you're doing a comparison with here for 00. Then for this next row, it'll be the second one versus the second one comparison. That's why you're getting a 1. This is going to kind of mess this up later for what I'll show you. So something that we overlooked, all right? You'll see examples online that are showing you how to actually calculate this and print off what we just had, and it basically stops there. But what I want to show you is taking the original tweet, finding the highest value for the cosine similarity per row and extract that value and then return the cosine similarity and the actual tweet that corresponds with that number, which will be the index number. You'll see in a second. We have quite a few steps to manipulate this process, all right? The first step here, I decided I need to iterate inside of our data frame, which I converted into a list of values, of nested values. And what I needed to do was figure out let me print this off for you. So for this part one, it's printing off, this is the index, or this is the row number, this is the index position for that row. So you have 50 rows, you have 50 index positions per row. This is the cosine similarity for 00. This is the cosine similarity for row 0, index position 1. That's what this is. So at 00, we need to take care of. At 11, we'll scroll down. At 11, 22, etc., we're going to change these to zeros, because what I'm going to do is put these back into a data frame and allow us to do comparisons to find the maximum value per row. With this one here, it's going to mess you up, so you can't really do what I'm trying to prove. That's what allows us at the second part here to do. If the 00 occurs or the 11 occurs, basically just append a 0 to that and replace that 1 is what's going on here, and just leave your row number, your index position the same. Otherwise, if you're not at a 11, 22, 33, etc., just append those values in. And that's what's going on here. You'll notice this is what's changed. The next thing we're going to do is another two-step thing. You could pause this and read it real quick, but I need to do a few things. I need to create a default dictionary where I'm going to store those values that we had above. So let's go back. I'm going to take each one of these index or these row positions. That's going to be my key. Then my value is going to be the cosine similarity values here. So I iterate through and create my default dictionary with my new values that you're going to see. Here's the row number, and here's the 50 values that correspond to that row number, which now is giving me the ability to start creating a data frame later. So you'll be able to see that. So I create that data frame, and you got a 50 by 50 matrix, and everything that was on the diagonal that you see here, that's 0, were the ones. We take that and iterate through it, and we take the largest value by row and save that in here. But that's going to give me not the value, but the index position of where the largest value is. This is going to correspond to our original data frame, where now we can iterate through this list and just append a new list with the tweets that we want. From here, I iterate inside of the positional argument and store the new list with our new tweets corresponding to their largest similarity values here. That's what's getting printed out. What I did was store the actual values here, which are the similarity values for all the positions that had the highest value. And that's what this is. So now we got another piece to our puzzle. Let's go down to the next spot where we put everything together. This is the data frame of the tweets where I took out all the HTML stuff, the links that were unnecessary, and I concatenate everything together. Print out the first 8 entries so you can see what's going on here. We parse this through. We have our parse tweets, our tweets based on similarity, which were their max similarity per row, and its actual value. So then we could see here's this particular tweet, and here's the value that was most similar to it for that row. Same thing for all of these. So you'll say, okay, well, what do you mean similar per row? Well, each row and column, you have a 50 by 50. You originally had 50 rows or 50 items, but then you're doing a comparison-wise adjustment for each. So that's why you have a 50 by a 50. And then I did, this one had, I think, the highest value for similarity, which was 90, basically 0.91 out of 1. And you'll see that it's fairly similar with what it's talking about. What I wanted to also do was show you, make this a little smaller, but a heat map so you can see what this actually looks like. So here's all of our entries. Here's our 50 by 50. And you'll notice that there's some spots in here that seem like they're equaling 1 or very close to 1, which would mean that you have something that's extremely similar to the next tweet. You're going to see where this was kind of an issue and one of the things that I need to mention in this code. There's a few things that we missed, and that's what I want to bring to your attention now. That's what you look at for exploring your data and understanding what's really going on and giving an explanation of when things go awry. A few things that we should consider. Due to the cosine similarity here, there were 7 entries that had retweets which were the same exact data. Not all 7 were the same, but you may have like 2 that were same, and 2 in the same, and maybe 3 were the same, something like that. So in the future, what you want to look for is, are there duplicates in your data? Check to see if they're actual valid entries. Did these tweets come from the same person? Did they come from different people? Since they're retweets, you know, for instance, in this case, it may have came from different people retweeting it. That's what would give you the ability to have the same tweet just by a different person. Understanding what's going on with your data is highly important, and you should always look and investigate instead of blindly do something. And if there's a circumstance, maybe not in this case, you may be able to get rid of or discard data. That just depends on a case-by-case situation. So I noticed that there were 43 out of 50 unique entries, 7 of which were the retweets that were the same. This tweet that was parsed, it had the lowest cosine similarity of 0. And it's just pure nonsense. And it looks like, one, this may be either a troll or somebody just giving junk or someone possibly not knowing how to use Twitter and just throwing people's handles for some weird reason. I don't really know what's going on there. But that's an explanation of why this one would have a complete 0 and not look like anything else. But I'd like to say, please like, share, and subscribe. And if you subscribe, turn on that notification bell. I hope this brought utility to someone. Feel free to go here on my Instagram and Twitter, as well as if you'd like to help support the channel, hit me up here. Thanks for watching. See you in the next video. Bye.